Now, before I go to my main topic, I would like to brief about the physical determinants of water movement and between the intracellular, between the intravascular space and the interstitial, between the intravascular space and the interstitial tissue. So there are three main determinants that decide that determine where the water will move. First is the osmolarity. Second is the plasma oncotic pressure, and the third is the capillary permeability. So first is the osmolarity. Osmolarity is the number of milliosmoles per liter of the solution, and the osmolality is the number of milliosmoles per kilogram of the solution. So these two terms actually can be interchangeably used in physiologically important dilute salt solution, where the osmolarity is equal to, almost equal to osmolality. First, now the osmotic pressure. The osmotic pressure is the hydrostatic pressure that is generated when solutions of unequal osmolarity are separated via semipermeable membrane. So it acts to equalize the osmolarity of solution on both sides of the membrane. So here the water will move from low osmolarity to the high osmolarity solution to equalize the osmolarity on both sides of the semipermeable membrane. The second thing is plasma oncotic pressure. Plasma oncotic pressure is the osmotic pressure that is generated by large molecules that do not pass through the semipermeable membrane. So it draws the water from the extracellular space. It is mainly produced by the albumin and to a lesser extent by the immunoglobulins, fibrinogen and the other large molecular weight plasma protein. And the third thing is the capillary permeability, relative capillary permeability. First, I can say the capillary permeability in the peripheral and the cerebral capillaries are little bit different. Here, in the peripheral capillaries, the pore size in the endothelium is 65 angstrom. That allow free water and the small ions like sodium, potassium, chloride to pass through them. But the large molecules like protein cannot pass through them. And in the cerebral capillaries, the size of the pore in the endothelium is 7 angstrom only, and there were tight junctions also present. So it forms the blood-brain barrier, and it allows only water to pass through these pores. And there is no movement of sodium or small ions, and the protein can occur through these pores. So due to this fact, the movement of water in the peripheral tissues is governed mainly by the plasma concentration of large molecules. So it is the oncotic gradient that decide the water movement in the peripheral tissues. And in the cerebral capillaries, the fluid movement is determined by osmotic gradient that is generated by both large molecules and small ions. So the main topic. The options available for the intraoperative fluid management are the crystalloids, colloids, hyperosmotic solutions that we are given to reduce the cerebral edema, and the dextrose solution. So first, the crystalloids. Crystalloids are the solution that do not contain any high molecular weight compound and have an osmotic pressure of 0. So crystalloid may be hyposmolar, isoosmolar or hyperosmolar and may or may not contain glucose. So the hyposmolar solution should be avoided at any cost as they decrease the plasma osmolarity and increase the cerebral edema. Among isoosmolar crystalloids, the list is very long. And the commonly used one is the sodium chloride 0.9% that we are using in day-to-day practice. In neurosurgical patients, but it is an isotonic, but it may differ in many aspects with the plasma. First is the chloride concentration. The chloride concentration of sodium chloride is very high as compared to the plasma. And the second is the other electrolytes like calcium, magnesium, potassium. It is lacking in them also. And the third thing is the osmolarity and the sodium. The osmolarity and sodium is also slightly more than the plasma. So it is actually not as isotonic as the plasma. The second is the plasma light. Plasma light has a composition similar to the plasma. So it is more physiological than the normal saline. The other thing is sodium 0.9% NaCl. It is a hyperchlorated solution. So it can cause the hyperchloramate metabolic acidosis. That may lead to renal dysfunction. It can also cause reduced gastric blood flow and delayed recovery of the gut function. That may lead to QMB and consequently rise in the ICU. Plasma light is an isoosmotic solution. It is more physiological than normal saline and maintain a stable metabolic status. So it should be preferred solution. There are a few studies that are in favor with the plasma light. Like this is a recent study on the craniotomy patient that conclude metabolic profile was better maintained with the balanced preferred solution than the normal saline. This is another recent review in 2020. It also says the acid-base alteration were lower and the chloride load was less among in balanced solution as compared to the other solutions. So the treatment with balanced isotonic crystalloid is preferred over administration of 0.9% NaCl in patients undergoing neurosurgical procedure. Colloids. Colloids have a large insoluble molecule that increase the intravascular oncotic pressure and draw the water from the extravascular space. It improves the mean arterial pressure by the increased intravascular volume. The commonly used colloids are heterostat, albumin, dextran, and the plasma. These are the composition of commonly used colloids. Heterostat is a 6% solution of hydroxyethyl starch in normal saline. It may be administered during blood loss on 1:1 volume basis until a transfusion threshold is met. Maximum dose that can be given in a normal, otherwise healthy patient is 50 ml per kg. And it should be avoided in patients of sepsis, burn injury, or critically ill patient with pre-existing renal dysfunction. And evidence regarding the effect of HES on coagulation are complex. Now the dextran. Dextran has so many adverse effects, so its clinical use is very limited. FFP should be administered only in an attempt to correct the coagulation defect. Albumin is available for infusion in 5% and 25% solutions. It is expensive also, and there is no proven advantage over other colloids has been established in neurosurgical patients. So this is a recent systematic review that says to maintain the hemodynamics, the colloids were better in if they compare the crystalloids and colloid groups in a critical care unit patient, and they found the colloids maintain hemodynamics better than the crystalloids. This is a recent review article that compare the adverse effect of crystalloids and colloids, and they suggest the colloid fluid is indicated when the infused crystalloid volume exceeds 3 to 4 liters. And plasma volume support is still needed, and transfusion of blood product is not yet needed. So, in conclusion, the colloid can be used for fluid resuscitation in addition to crystalloid in patients with acute blood loss, and it better maintain the hemodynamic stability than the crystalloids. Now, we have discussed the which fluid we should give. Now, come to the how much fluid we should give. So, the optimal fluid management is important to prevent the perioperative complications. Both hypovolemia and hypervolemia can cause adverse outcome. So for the fluid to be optimally managed, it should be studied by some hemodynamic parameters, like the static parameters that we are using routinely, like blood pressure, heart rate, urine output, central venous pressure, and pulmonary artery occlusion pressure. The other are dynamic parameters that are use now. These are the pulse pressure variation, stroke volume variation, systolic blood pressure variation, change in the IVC catheter, IVC diameter, and the plethora variability. So these are better in trend or in trend now, because the dynamic parameters provide a more accurate picture of volume status and group responsiveness than static hemodynamic parameters. So they are more in trend. The PLETH variability index has an added advantage that it is a non-invasive method, and it is also being popular now. So the goal-directed food therapy has been recommended for patients undergoing neurosurgical procedure. The dynamic parameters superior to traditionally used static parameters for assessment of fluid responsiveness are superior, and they provide a more accurate picture of volume status and fluid responsiveness than static hemodynamic parameters.